the final aspiration is to build a brain-inspired computer with 100 trillion synapses fitting within a 2-liter shoebox and consuming 1 kilowatt of power. So on this journey, we begin by first looking at neuroscience. What you see here is the largest long-distance wiring diagram in the primate brain. Pictured around the circumference are different patches in the monkey cortex, subcortex, and connecting them are wires that were painstakingly acquired one by one over 6 decades and compiled in a database called COCOMAC by late Ralph Cotter. We extracted the data, and after 4 years of work, we're able to put this graph with 383 areas, 6,602 connections. This network subserves perception, action, cognition, emotion, interaction. It subserves sight, sound, taste, touch, and smell. And the reason that we were interested in it is we as computer scientists wanted to study brain as a mathematical network apart from its biological wet substrate. And then we began building models of this at increasing scale from just a few hundred neurons to rat scale, mouse scale, cat, monkey, so forth. And the whole purpose of our model building was to mathematize this network with the goal of understanding how power, volume, speed vary as a function of three fundamental architectural metrics: computation, communication, and memory. And what we did is in 2012, we put together a simulation at the scale of 100 trillion synapses, same as roughly the estimate of synapses in the human brain, with simple mathematical models for neurons and synapses. This simulation required 96 racks of BlueJean Q Sequoia, 1.5 million processors, 1.5 petabytes of main memory, and 6.3 million threads. And yet, the simulation ran 1,500 times slower than real time. So it really begins to portray the disparity. So if one were to imagine a hypothetical, and I emphasize hypothetical, supercomputer designed to run 100 trillion synapses at real time, it would consume 12 gigawatts of power. That's enough to power Los Angeles, New York City, and in Karl Heinz's honor, Heidelberg for free. So, in contrast, the human brain consumes essentially 12 watts. So that's a billion-fold disparity. This is not to say that today's architectures are bad. It's to say that today's architectures are dramatically different from how the brain is structured, how it computes, and how we ought to look for inspiration for a new architecture. So as Karl Heinz mentioned, the power disparity is a function of two variables. One is the underlying technology, and the second is architecture. The underlying technology of the brain is biochemical, biophysical, wet substrate, organic. And what we have today is an inorganic CMOS substrate. So we also focused our attention on the architecture which is ready for new technology as civilization begins to make them widely available. So let's look at the architecture, and let's look at von Neumann architecture carefully. So this graph plots on the x-axis clock frequency of microprocessors since 43 years ago, the advent of 4004. And on the y-axis, it shows power density. Over 43 years, we have increased clock frequency by over three orders of magnitude, and power density by over two orders of magnitude to create a relentless march in the northeast direction of this chart. Now, the brain is not on that territory. It sits alone in the southwest corner. So if you continue on that path, we are not going to get to a brain-inspired architecture. The desired path is think different. So before we think different, let's understand the essence of the von Neumann architecture. In its very essence, von Neumann architecture takes computation, memory, separates the two, and moves data across long distances, consuming energy, between the two via bus, which becomes the memory wall, the bottleneck. This architecture is fundamentally sequential, is fault-prone, it's symbolic, it leads to a completely different programming paradigm than the brain. What we have developed is a very different way of thinking, which is what we call a network of neurosynaptic cores. What you see here is 9 cores tiled. Each core tightly integrates memory, computation, communication. The cores are interconnected with one another via an event-driven network. There is no clock anywhere in the system. The entire architecture is parallel. The architecture is distributed. The architecture is fault tolerant. If some of the cores die, we don't shed tears over them. It's modular. Just by tiling one simple unit, one can achieve scalability within a chip, and as you'll soon see, across chips. It's non-von Neumann, and it is simple to design. The complexity of design is proportional to the size of the core, which is a few hundred microns by a few hundred microns, but capability of the chips is proportional to what you can fabricate in a process and use economically. So this is actually an ideal circumstance. So going forward, what we did in 2011, about 3 years ago, as a proof of concept, we demonstrated two neurosynaptic cores. Each core had 256 neurons at the scale of a worm brain. Each core was event-driven, integrated memory, computation, communication, and was the building block of the architecture that we are beginning to build. The cores could do very simple things like play Pong. And actually, our DARPA Synapse Program Manager, Todd Hilton, is in the audience. And at the boundary between phase one and two, we had him play the chip. He lost. We got our next phase funding. So thanks, Todd, for losing. But those were the humble beginnings. And then the next idea was to simply tile this course in a sea. Now, just because the cores are tiled, that doesn't mean that they implement a two-dimensional architecture. They can be interconnected in a rich interconnection fabric, allowing a limitless possibilities in architecture, and you'll see that today. And going from there, just about 3 months ago, we unveiled the chip, which took not just one, not just two, but 4,096 cores in a 64 by 64 array to create a chip that requires 5.4 billion transistors in Samsung's 28 nanometer low power process. The chip has 1 million neurons, 256 million synapses. Now, as the chip came, we were full of trepidation. Completely new architecture, a new process within IBM, a novel hybrid synchronous asynchronous circuit design methodology was used. Completely different way to test it. So we built a test board, and you can see the TrueNote chip in socket. And to our great relief, and because of the hard work of the team, the chip works flawlessly. This is a thermal plot. So now you can clearly see where TrueNote is. The chip consumes 70 milliwatts. It has a power density of 20 milliwatts per square centimeter. That's 5,000-fold less than power density of modern server-grade microprocessors. The chip, we're going to publish a paper next week at Supercomputing, where we show that it's capable of 86 billion synaptic operations per second per watt. This is literally a supercomputer size of a postage stamp consuming power of a hearing aid battery. So now, the chip was published, as I mentioned, 3 months ago. And the chip has a very unique property. It allows homogeneous scaling. So you put two of these together, it behaves like twice the chip. The chips can be interconnected seamlessly in east-west, north-south direction. So to demonstrate, we are presenting a system which is working with 16 chips, 16 million neurons, 4 billion synapses. This is literally a supercomputer. To simulate this would require more than 4 racks of conventional computers, and yet you would not be able to get to real time. So you can see the promise of neuromorphic computing is slowly becoming real. So let me show you a couple snippets of the application. You'll see them in great detail later. What you see here is a clip from DARPA NeoVision Challenge, camera on top of Hoover Tower at Stanford. And the system is recognizing cars, bicyclists, trucks, people in real time, consuming orders of magnitude less power than previous solutions. Now, this is a stationary camera. There's another part of the DARPA NeoVision Challenge, a moving camera with Professor Laurent E.T. flying over Los Angeles in a helicopter shooting scenes. And again, the chip can pick up these objects while consuming minuscule amount of power. So you can begin to move such low power computing to the sensor, to the edge. Sensor becomes the computer. So we talked about hardware, we talked about application, but what about programming paradigm? So Jeff Welser mentioned Fortran. Fortran was developed by John Backus, who spent his latter half of his career here. And in his Turing Award acceptance prize, he pointed out one lemon bottleneck. Now, it's not just a hardware bottleneck, he said. It's also an intellectual bottleneck that has kept us to word at a time thinking. We're trying to solve complex problem of multimodal sensory understanding with if-then-else loops strung together in a long sequence. So stretch your imagination, and if you think that these are all the algorithms that were invented for the von Neumann computer, von Neumann paradigm, then the first challenge we faced was TrueNote looks like this, right? Square peg, a round hole. It's like trying to hammer in a screw. Wrong paradigm. We have to shift the thinking from long sequential instructions to short parallel thinking. And to enable this thinking, the first step we did was we developed a simulator, multi-threaded, multi-platform, highly scalable simulator that's spike-to-spike equivalent with the chip. Of course, it runs several orders of magnitude slower and consume several orders of magnitude more energy. And then we developed an end-to-end tool suite to do design, development, deployment, and debugging, which is essentially to transform data into a program that can be loaded onto the simulator. Once you have that, the simulator can be replaced by the chip. And once you've loaded the program onto the chip, it can be put in real applications where one can stream real-time data through it while consuming very little power and very little area. So now, to make this technology available to vertical industries, to business partners, to government agencies, and to academia, we've developed a single chip board. It sits right here. And for some strange reasons, it's been called Catherine the Great. I'll let you figure why. And to promulgate the new ideas behind it, we created a new training program that we fondly call the Synapse University. So you're looking at the regent of Synapse University. So, and I invite you to attend. And going beyond, sort of let's just summarize where we are. So starting from the conception of the project in 2004 to Almaden Institute in this very room in May 2006, which brought together luminaries like Jerry Edelman and Henry Markram, to mouse and rat scale simulations on the largest Blue Gene L supercomputer at that time with 32,000 processors, to winning the DARPA grant, initially managed by Todd Hilton with Cornell, Rajit Manohar, with Stanford, Wisconsin, to CAT scale simulations, to wiring diagram of the brain, to the worm scale chips that we spoke of, to the human scale simulations at scale of 100 trillion synapses on the Compass simulator, to developing an end-to-end ecosystem with a simulator, a new programming language, new learning algorithms, and a new curriculum, to the True North chip and the boards here today. The key message is that the technology, the tools, and the teams are ready to begin in market and in collaboration with academic partners experimentation. IBM envisions a shared, collaborative, joint ecosystem approach with vertical industries, business partners, universities, government agencies to unlock societal applications, economic benefits, as well as continue future rounds of technology and ecosystem development. To summarize, the premise of brain-inspired computing is low power, small size, real-time performance for multimodal, sensor-rich applications spanning the spectrum from mobility to scalability. So just in conclusion, let me thank DARPA for the generous support of $53.5 million to date, two visionary program managers, Dr. Gilprecht, Dr. Todd Hilton, and Chagan Batar, who has been from ONR supervising the project since the very inception. I would like to thank all the university partners, Stanford, Cornell, Columbia, Wisconsin, UC Merced, Columbia, as well as Inilabs, which joined us in phase three. And I would like to single out both Inilabs and Cornell for their deep partnership over the last 2 years, as well as thank 8 IBM labs and fabs. Thank Samsung for offering to do such a small project and their leadership, as well as thank Lawrence Berkeley National Lab or Simon Lawrence Livermore National Lab for really giving us access to Dawn supercomputing, Sequoia supercomputer. And finally, of course, this project would not have succeeded without effort of about 200 people who have contributed to this. I would like to thank all my colleagues. And here's just a small sample of them. So as you thank me, I'll invite them to rise up and share in the applause with me.